Welcome back. We are debating whether big-time college athletes should actually get paid. In the crossfire are USA Today sports columnist Christine Brennan and NBA Hall of Famer and legend Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And we've been really trying to figure out, to get our heads wrapped around this thing, because what you're proposing, it sounds like common sense, but it's actually pretty radical in that you would have people showing up at college, they've got their book bag, they've got their linen, and rather than them just being a regular student, these people would be getting paid, and I guess they'd be getting paid maybe more than their professors, getting paid as much as a college president. I mean, how is this going to actually work? And aren't you concerned that if we create this superstar class of these like multimillionaire students wandering around, I mean, what does that do to all the rest of the kids who just want to play for the love of the game?
The people that want to play for the love of the game can do that. There are intramural leagues that they can play in. The people that want to play competitively against other schools, I think they deserve to get some remuneration from what they create for the school. The school makes a lot of money. You got coaches in this country that are making like several million dollars a year, and they're not supposed to be amateurs, but the people who are actually going out there and going to practice every day, they're supposed to be amateurs. The hypocrisy is too blatant and obvious to ignore, man. Something has to be done about it.
Look, Christine, let me build on what Kareem just said. Sure. We have a map, which I think may have come actually from your newspaper,
okay,
which is the coaches as highest paid state employees. If you look at this map, I think it's like 37 or 39 states, you have a coach as the highest paid state employee.
Yeah.
Now, isn't it a little bit silly to suggest that an industry with this size TV contract, with this size salaries for the coaches, somehow is, quote, an amateur industry?
Right, yeah. Well, as long as it stays in the college model, I guess we have to consider it that. Again, if the universities want to keep this as a college endeavor, they've got to play by the rules of the law, and the law says you're paying all of your athletes, the Olympic sport, the non-revenue sports as well. But without a doubt, things are out of whack. When I started my career, I covered the Miami Hurricanes for the Miami Herald back in the 80s. President there, Tad Foote at the time, talked about making Miami an Ivy League institution. It's a private school. It's an excellent school. And at that exact same time, the Miami football program was taking hold. And I covered the first national title. Within a couple years, Jimmy Johnson shows up, Dennis Erickson, and the rest is history. If you followed college sports, you know that became a renegade program. So here was an example of a university president who said all the right things, and the football program took off. So the presidents, frankly, in my mind, are the people who have let this happen. They could have policed it. They could have corralled it. They haven't. And they are as culpable as anybody in this conversation.
But isn't that true? I mean, it's not just blatant things. Isn't it true across the whole system that the pressure to win, the pressure to be good enough to be in that nice TV contract, leads people to fudge at the margins all the time?
Absolutely. We're seeing it from Penn State to USC. I cannot remember this many incidents of recruiting violations or other things that have been going on.
So wouldn't we be better off just to be honest and have it up in the open and say, look, this is the nature of the system?
Well, as I said, yes, but honesty is good. I think all four of us here would agree. we're for honesty. But what we're talking about, we're looking at this through the prism of sports, which, of course, here we are. But we're looking at men's basketball and football. If you think of a university, UCLA, incredible sports all the way around, from gymnastics, what have you. My alma mater, Northwestern. Women's lacrosse has won 7 of the last NCAA titles. Gives Northwestern an incredibly wonderful, proud feeling for our women's lacrosse team that I didn't even know existed 10 years ago. The point being, you can't just take football and men's basketball out of the equation as long as you're going to work with the laws of the United States of America.
Well, fine. That's all good, well and good. But first of all, you're in some ways making my point. You have this big pile of cash that corrupts grown people. Let's give it to the kids. I mean, I don't know that this makes sense to me. I'm thinking about my own kid. I've got a son named Cabral. He's 9 years old. He is a great soccer player. And you know why he plays? For the love of the game. Do you think he would be a better player if at the end of every game he got more cookies and more snacks than the other kids because he was a great player? What happened to the love of the game?
The love of the game can continue, but what needs to be dealt with is the fact that all this money is, the whole college system is awash in all this money, and they purposely keep the people who are making this money from getting their hands on any of it.
But what would you be mad?
So many of them come from poor circumstances and could use it for a number of things, but they don't get to do it.
I don't understand then why you aren't just saying the kids shouldn't go to college at all. There should just be some kind of new league for young people or something that's a professional league. But if you're talking about college students, it seems to me that the point of them being there is for them to get in those books and learn. Now, obviously, there might be some tiny minority that get a chance to do what you did. Most of those young people, though, are not going to be benefiting. Where's this money even going to come from to pay these superstar athletes? You're talking about, you know, the NCAA. That's a not-for-profit, isn't it?
No, it's a lot of profit going on there. I told you, the president of the NCAA made $1.7 million.
Well, that seems like a lot.
That's a lot of money, and it's not this isn't equitable.
Yeah.
And the whole idea is that the people who are generating this revenue should get some of it. I'm not saying that they should get it all, but they should get some of it and allow all of the schools to share. I think revenue sharing is also something that has to be part of all of
it. I think it's important, though, to add at this point that a college scholarship is worth something.
And they get a lot of money.
They get a lot of money. My newspaper, USA Today, did come up with a story a few months ago talking about the value of a college scholarship. So you're at UCLA. You obviously got a chance, of course, to play on three national championship teams. You're getting incredible coaching. You're getting, of course, an education if you want it. USA Today said $120,000 a year.
You're in the 1%.
What about those players, though, that go out there and guy tears his knee up and they take his scholarship away?
Well, that's wrong.
He can't continue at the school. He has to either come out of his pocket or go to a JC. All of a sudden, his career is down the tube, and he has nothing to show for it. Something has to be done about that.
Well, right? we might get a bit of agreement here.
It's a terrible bit of exploitation there, and yeah. something has to be done about
that. But one step would be to require that when you give a scholarship out, as long as they are trying, they get to keep the scholarship. I mean, you wouldn't want to give it out if somebody that dropped out didn't do anything. But so that, in other words, if you got injured, you automatically get the scholarship for all 4 years.
California has passed a law known as the Student Athlete Bill of Rights, and schools generating more than $10 million a year have to provide for all of the guys that are on scholarship so that if they get injured, an insurance policy will pay for their rehabilitation and enable them to finish school. Now, the state of California has done that, but the NCAA should be doing that.
Mm.
That should be on them to protect these people in some way so that at least they get the opportunity to have an education. Mm. But there are so many of these guys that are just going there to be seen. In many ways, the NCAA is an unpaid minor league for the NFL.
In that sense, Christine, wouldn't you agree that the NCAA probably ought to be deeply reformed, that in its current operating system, it's just wrong?
I think reform is a good thing. And I think what's happened, not to defend the NCAA, people would laugh at the thought that I'm defending them because I have been so critical in many ways. But they are working on a model new that comes from a different era. The money, there was a 1984 Supreme Court decision that basically put all these teams on TV all the time. The money is flowing like crazy, just what we need, more money, right? Because if you're paying athletes, the question is, could there even be more corruption? We've seen it anyway, but at all times. But I think your point is a good one, that the NCAA is trying to work in a system that no longer exists, and money is flowing everywhere. But I don't know that we want to, I guess my point earlier, I hate to think what it would look like if it's the Wild West.
But shouldn't you have an equity when this happened to you, when somebody's identity can go on for 30 or 40 years being exploited by other people with no compensation at all? So you have, whether it's in a game that's being sold or it's in a brochure or it's in a sweatshirt or what have you. I mean, the folks who are in the field sweating or in the stadium sweating aren't getting that money as a general rule.
I would quibble with the word exploited because, again, I think there is incredible value to that college education. As I said, $120,000 is an estimate that USA Today had from experts. And I think when you think about it, whether it's the lacrosse player, the swimmer, the football player, men's or women's basketball player, when they graduate, let's say they don't go pro, but they have gotten to know the bank president, and the bank president from that school hires them. What is that worth? And, again, that stage that you had at UCLA, what was that worth to you? I mean, that's how I first heard about you and was aware of you. And yes, you went on to the NBA, But I'm sure you have teammates who had that great moment at UCLA who are still living careers to this day because of what they did at UCLA.
That's possible. But on the other side of that, you have a school. There was a player, a football player named Dexter Manley, who was able to attend Oklahoma State University, and he played there for 4 years. And we find out after his professional career is finished that he was illiterate. Now, how is somebody going to go through 4 years of a college and come out being illiterate? That is rank and obvious exploitation. He was there because of his athletic talent. That's the only reason he was there. And, you know, if we let these things continue to happen, it's just going to get worse.
Look, this is, I hope we can come back again and continue to come. This has been a great and very enlightening conversation. I want to thank both Christine and Kareem for coming.
My pleasure.
It's been a terrific thing.